Hi everyone, welcome back to the Scottish Paranormal Podcast. I'm your host Chris, and here we delve into the multitude of strange occurrences that happen within Scotland and beyond. You can contact us with your accounts at the Scottish Paranormal Podcast at gmail.com. You can find us on all social media channels, and you can contact us by either means. If you want to help the show grow, please like, subscribe and share. Wherever you pick up the content, this could be via audio or via YouTube. We'll get right into it now, and we'll welcome our next guest into the show.
Right.
How are you doing, Stephen?
I'm doing great, actually. It's a lot of good things happening. Yeah, a lot of good things.
You must be a busy man.
Right now. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah, it's about 11:30 here. So, coffee in hand.
Yeah, I got some tea, iced tea.
I was going to avoid the coffee because I'm going to go to sleep afterwards, but it'll keep me up. So. Yeah, so listen, thanks for coming back on again. It's good having you on. There's a lot of interesting times going on right now, very busy. I can imagine you'd be quite busy, everything that's gone on, you know what I mean, in regards to the hearings.
Oh,
more hearings coming up. It's just every week there's more stuff coming out. So if you'd be so kind, could you give the listeners just a quick synopsis of yourself?
Yeah.
You've been on before, obviously, but there's new listeners there coming on. So just to give you a quick kind of rundown, you basically your accolades and stuff like that. If you want to do that, it'd be great. Sure.
So I'm a political activist and a disclosure advocate. Disclosure, capital D advocate. The goal is simple. 77 years after the events at Roswell, as a benchmark, the government has got to finally confirm that we have this non-human engagement. As far as I'm concerned, it's extraterrestrials. Someone can prove they're time travelers or interdimensional. Do it. Till then, they're extraterrestrials. They say they're from the stars, and I'm pretty sure they are. The government has embargoed this from us. For national security reasons. It's been a long, hard slog. A lot of downside to that policy, though it's understandable why they did it in the early day, certainly between 47 and 91. Because while they learned about ETs, the ET reality, obviously, with the crash vehicle at Roswell and the pilots dead, not all of them were dead, it was one alive, I think, at least one of them. They also knew that the Soviets had the nuclear tech. They were going to build bombs too, and missiles. And so, and we had already kind of made them our mortal enemy, even after they helped us defeat the Nazis. It's like, you know, the Nazis are out of the way. We need a new enemy.
Yeah.
So, of course, we agreed that we would be each other's enemies. It's worked out so well.
Yeah.
And so, but in the last 20, 25 years, this embargo is just unacceptable. And so I'm an activist trying to, along with many other people, trying to get the U.S. to a position where it simply has to confirm this truth. Another nation could do it first. That's fine. I think it might be in best interest of everyone if the U.S. went first. Mm-hmm. And disclosure, by that I mean capital D disclosure, formal confirmation of ET presence. By the head of state, by the president, not by anybody else. The only person that can really trigger disclosure is the president, not the vice president, not the chief of staff, not the joint chiefs. It has to be the president. So that's where we're headed, and we're getting close. We're getting very, very close.
Do you think, have you became any more or any less optimistic with the new administration coming in?
Very complex situation there. We are, enough has happened in the last 7 years to end a truth embargo right now. Mm-hmm. we've had two hearings in the Senate. I mean, in the House, there's been four or five briefings where a person has come up and briefed one of the members of Congress, usually in private session. There's 40 or more witnesses that have come forward that want to testify. But we need a major hearing to set the president up for this. There are powerful witnesses, that about 20 of them, a solid week. And the Congress has done that before, often on far less important issues than this. But about 5 days, 2 a.m, 2 p.m, and it's over. Blows the truth embargo up. Yeah. And then the president, who's watching it along with many tens of millions of people around the world, can come forward and end the truth embargo. There's plenty of time to do this before the end of November, end of December. Plenty of time. And the Senate can do it. And we're sending that message to them every way we can. Either Gillibrand or Warner, hold a hearing in the Intel Committee. Mm-hmm. It armed services would do, but the Intel Committee is really, I think, the place. It's the most nonpartisan of all the committees. Mm-hmm. Not that the Senate Armed Services isn't pretty nonpartisan, but the Senate Intel Committee has been leading on the legislation going all the way back to 2020. So that's it. Mark Warner is the chairman. He can call it. They send the, you know, hopefully they give the witnesses a nice hotel room and airfare and get them into D.C. And that will do it. The president will come forward and we can have disclosure by the end of December. That's the way it should be. That is the best choice right now. If they don't do it, then the truth embargo will carry over into the next administration, which is coming in facing a huge array of problems, both domestically and foreign, in the midst of a rather significant political storm, as you guess you could say. Mm-hmm. And so the truth embargo would be hanging over all of that, and even much more difficult to deal with. It's going to be a mess. So, but if the Senate doesn't act now, and we don't get that hearing, then it passes to that administration. I happen to think that if that is the case, the president-elect will one way or another, will probably get disclosure before the end of March. Mm-hmm. The issue is simply ripe and ready to take. He has been asked many questions. His answers have been not particularly extensive, almost casual.
Yeah.
But he's answered the questions. He certainly never said, no, there's nothing to this, or I wouldn't do it. In the interview with the now seen about 80, maybe 80 million views that the president-elect took with Joe Rogan, the president kind of went there and referred to the UFO files as well as the Kennedy documents. And then we also know that some of the people around him are bringing it up. The sense, therefore, is that he's literally being teed up to do this. Now, there's two other reasons why he would act. One of them is the fact that within the core or most prominent agenda of the new administration is the idea of attacking what they call the deep state. I'm not a fond of that word. I don't think it's helpful. I don't think it's well defined. However, military intelligence complex, sure. Mm-hmm. Excessive secret world, yes. And this issue is essentially controlled by and maintained by the military intelligence complex. And it is a lie and it is dysfunctional. And so it fits within their agenda. And then the fourth reason why by the end of March seems very realistic is that unlike Biden, Obama, Bush, pretty much any president in the modern era, this president-elect will do whatever the hell he wants. If he wants to do something, he can't be talked out of it. So he just doesn't have that problem. So he can do it. Now, how it's done matters. If I were approached by the new administration for my thoughts, I would say, look, you control the Senate now. And of course, the Senate Intel Committee is now again has a Republican chair. Not that that matters. This issue is and should be nonpartisan, and pretty much everyone agrees. But get with your Senate Intel chairman or chairwoman and say, look, let's get this hearing done and get the witnesses in. Could do it in February easily. Mm-hmm. And if they do that, then the testimony, as I say, if it's what I know it can be, not one person or four people, but 20, basically 20 David Grushes, but probably substantial firsthand witnesses, it blows the truth embargo up. And then the president can come forward almost immediately and say, look, this is true. And of course, we're going to use the legislation that's been passed to get all this out to you. We're going to bring the truth out. That would be best. But the new president may very well to be proved to go unilateral and simply call a meeting together and say, I have been informed to my satisfaction that we have this extraterrestrial non-human intelligence engaging us. We have vehicles and so forth. And I'm going to get all that out to you. But while we're waiting for all that stuff to come into the public arena, I'm telling you, we're not alone. That's disclosure, capital D. It's a little messier. It's more. It's has problems.
Yeah.
Okay. The number one problem of a unilateral presidential disclosure, in my view, is that properly done, I think every major head of state in the world, with some uncertainty about Xi Jinping and Putin, will almost follow immediately and come forward and agree. But a unilateral disclosure by this president, they may be reluctant. They may hold back, and that would be awkward. So that's the situation right now. And there are more hearings coming. There's going to be a meeting on the Hill tomorrow. I intend to be there. Nancy Mace indicates he wants some more hearings. I think another hearing. I think she probably would love to have at least one more before the end of the year.
Mm-hmm.
They control the House, the Republicans, and they'll control the House next year. But the interest is high, and they're getting rave reviews. So I wouldn't be surprised. And all of this is just piling up on the truth embargo. So that's where we are, and it's going to keep me pretty busy for sure.
Totally. Did you notice a total shift and change in the knowledge from the congressmen and women between this hearing that was on the 13th of November compared to the hearing that David Grush was attending?
Yeah, these hearings were important in two different ways. The hearing on the 13th was more powerful, but a lot of people that are really excited about this and know something about it may not get that, and that's okay. The first hearing was basically a one-person hearing. It was essentially Grush with an extraordinary piece of information that he had taken some risks to come out with. But just having him by himself would have been not good, and they wisely found two other witnesses, two perfect witnesses, actually, to join him. David Grush and Ryan Graves, who had, you know, they were able to refer to the event that they were involved in. They'd already talked about that publicly, but they were now able to put it under oath. That's good. But that was about it. In terms of most other things, they didn't really have much to contribute. It was about Grush. And so, all right, big splash, what have you. But this hearing was different. This hearing, they brought in four people with extensive backgrounds in a range of expertise, working in government, working out of government, with substantial credentials. Lou Elizondo's credentials are well known. Admiral Gallaudet, Rear Admiral Gallaudet, was less known, but his credentials are quite good. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, there is the matter of Immaculate Constellation.
Mm-hmm.
And the Congresswoman Mace wanted, I think she actually wanted to try to get the Simon, the guy who brought the information forward, he'd gotten from the insider.
Yeah. Right?
And the information was from classified documents, mm-hmm. which he didn't get, but he got a summary.
Yeah.
And I'm not surprised about that. I think the law was broken there. And then, but actually handing over that classified documents would have broken even worse. Mm-hmm. And so summary, she got the summary, but she couldn't get the witness. And she got pressure too from the DOD, and she just told them, forget about it. And then went out and got Schellenberger, the journalist who was approached by Simon to get this story out. There's also Ross Colfer. But Schellenberger was the right choice. He's a strict investigative journalist. He's well known. He's well established. He's quite professional.
Yeah.
And so they got him, and then they got Mike Gold, who has had a career in a number of areas, touching on NASA and other things, space, what have you. And so what they had was four highly credentialed individuals, not there to talk about a single event, but rather to provide their perspective from their backgrounds. And then these perspectives overlapped and reinforced each other.
Yeah.
Now, this is the kind of substantive, heavy testimony that impresses high-end journalists, news editors, newspaper publishers, even academics and what have you. And so in that regard, it was more important and more powerful than the first here. And so I was very pleased. The room was completely packed. They added 20 more seats. Like a number of others, some friends and colleagues showed up by 5 a.m., roughly 5 a.m. And as it was, we still didn't get in that room until there were only 20 seats left. So I was in row four. I was disappointed. I wanted to be in row one, but there was another 100 or so that were in the TV room. The hall was packed for 4.5 hours after the House Rayburn Offen building opened. Mm-hmm. The energy in the hall was tremendous. Tons of photographs being taken, lots of filming by documentarists and whatever.
Yeah.
It was intense. The people were very, very, very intense. And so I was very pleased. I think the energy in the hall leading in was more intense than the energy for the Grush hearing, frankly. And then one note, we also learned that, and I think this was not quite, it wasn't nearly as extensive the first time around, but I haven't confirmed that, but this was live streamed by quite a few entities.
Yeah.
There was the potential for millions of people to have seen this.
Yeah.
C-SPAN, I haven't checked their views yet, but it was pretty substantial. You've got Reuters that did it. You've got one of the newspapers. You've got Scripps Press and so forth.
The News Nation live on YouTube. And just multiple streamed after that as well. It was everywhere. Yeah.
So I'm going to check how many streams were out there to try to get a sense of the size of the viewership. And then, of course, this hearing is archived on the web. It's not hard to find. And so how many millions of people will ultimately see it? I don't know. But it's a big number. And the Pentagon needs to understand that it's over. All right, please. Mm-hmm. Any more nonsense like the tantrums that were thrown by Kirkpatrick or the extraordinarily bogus special study they put out saying they didn't really find anything.
Yeah.
This is not helping. It's embarrassing the country. It's embarrassing the Department of Defense. And it's not right to the people that are serving you. They're being abused for you to keep a secret that is no longer a secret. Pursue a policy that's no longer productive. So they've really lost and they don't know it. In fact, and this chess game that we've been playing with the DOD and the military intelligence community for now a good solid 30 years, going back to about 1994, 1993, but in some respects, all the way back to 47, this has been a very difficult, challenging chess game with two players, the American people and the military intelligence community with the politicians watching from the side, in a sense, though they had to get involved. And the Pentagon basically is mated in three. It's checkmate in three. They don't, and I think they may know that, but in chess, some people, it's a very personal game. When you're losing in chess, it's, you take it personally. It's like your fundamental intelligence has failed. It's not like, you know, losing a baseball game. People get really upset. And some people, even though they know they're mated, will force you to play the game out until they are mated, and then they'll turn over the king or throw the board up in the air, whatever.
Yeah.
But that's poor form. When you realize you're mate in three, you turn your king over and shake the player's hand. Mm-hmm. That's where the Defense Department is. And right now, they're continuing to play the game out anyway. And that's, again, increasingly awkward. So that gives you just a sense of how I'm feeling after that hearing.
Do you think that, just in that analogy, playing the game out, do you think that they're even at a stage where they don't know how to end the game sometimes? Does that make sense? So it's that much of a big machine, the DOD, Pentagon, all the different faucets of this. Do you think that for them, it could be quite hard to end it?
Are you referring to the ET perspective on this?
No, I'm talking about the DOD. So the DOD aspect is, so like, if you're using the analogy of chess,
yeah,
and you could basically say, right, the game's up, right? But
yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Could they be in a position where there's that much a machine here with different aspects of it that they just don't know how to?
Can you explain?
Forgive me. So I mean,
you know that the Scottish accent and the Liverpool accent.
Yeah, I've
been to the UK. So I spent many times there. It's still the more challenging of the two. If you could rephrase that a little bit.
So what I'm saying is because this whole secret and the gatekeepers, right, and there's that much potential different aspects of people involved in it. You've got the defense contractors, you've got the CIA, you've got all these different parts of that machine. So there must be somebody at the top or multiple people at the top. So to try and get them to actually come forward and say the game's up.
Well, I'm telling them the game's up, right? Yeah. And I think they know it. But this is an extremely potent, powerful thing that's happening. It's the greatest paradigm shift in all of history.
Yeah.
And it has significant implications for just about everybody. The Congress, the president, the military intelligence complex, okay, which includes the armed services, NASA, pick it, right? Plus, of course, the truth embargo has been maintained now for so long, and there's going to be some very tough questions once this game is over.
Yeah.
Right? Very hard questions. Why this move? Why that move? Why didn't you give up sooner? They're not crazy. They're not looking forward to answering those questions. There are some concerns that maybe some people inside may feel there may be some liability, legal. I don't think that's going to happen. Then there's some, like the defense contractors, are concerned that it may affect their bottom line, though it's not clear on that. But they have had pretty much carte blanche to develop this tech and possibly even take some of the concepts and move them into some of their more commercial projects. I don't know. But there's that to consider. And then you have still, I'm sure, some quota of people in the Department of Defense who, based upon their worldview, still believe that the world knowing about this ET presence is a national security threat by some manner. And that's, if they feel that way, that's a very, that's legitimate. They have a right to feel that way. But increasingly, I think they're in the minority. I think they're very much in the minority now. Yeah. He's really hardcore. So, but there's enough to push back. And there's been some pushback, which really got underway in 2023 when Grush came forward, and then when Schumer submitted the fourth UAP Act for the 2020 2024 NDAA, which really was the RACT. It was the total package, and they really got upset about that. So they were pushing back.
Yeah.
But then we pushed back against them. And now that the Congress is increasingly on board, there's almost no stigma anymore.
Yeah.
And when members of the House, which is controlled by, will now be controlled by the incoming president, the same party as the incoming president, saying there's more hearings, and of course there's still hearings pending in the Senate, they can't win. And so I'm sure there's some cooperation there, but there's also some attempt to undermine this. And in the middle of it is Arrow. The All Domain Anomaly Resolution Office is caught right in the middle of this. It's a terrible place to be. They needed to set up such an office, not to find out what's going on. They already know what's going on, but they need to have that office in place when, if the president is going to announce, and all the legislation. So they set it up, but it's a really tough on any director of Arrow, because they really can't do anything.
Yeah.
I mean, they can act like they're doing something, but they really can't do anything. They're set up for a future situation, and that puts them in a tough spot. And as a result, there's been some heat there, and I get it. I mean, and so Arrow itself became a problem. And then Arrow was misused terribly by the Department of Defense when they forced it essentially to put out a bogus study accounting for what they'd done since they had begun. This was in addition to the mandated annual report. And this study was just grotesquely awful. It will go down in history, like the Condon report, only worse, because that was 1969. I get it. This is 2024. It's just awful.
Yeah, totally.
It's along the lines of, and probably worse than what the Department of Defense did in 1997, just before the 50th anniversary of Roswell was about to take place, and getting all this media anticipating maybe 100,000 people might show up. And the Roswell was way in play. It was a big deal. It was really capturing people's attention, and they decided they would push back incredibly insulting way by holding a press conference just days before that event, and having a gentleman by the name of Colonel Haynes come out and try to explain Roswell and the accounts that came from it. And it was so awful that the press were literally laughing at him, which means they were laughing at the Department of Defense and the Air Force. It was and that film still exists, and it's hard to watch it without cringing. And this is along those lines, though not as vaudevillian, but very soon they're going to be having press conferences where the press are going to start laughing at them again. And this is amidst extremely dangerous situations right now. We need the Department of Defense to get on with this, get it done, get in the post-disclosure world, because they have more important concerns than maintaining a 7-decade lie in the face of the truth. They've got to deal with the threat of a nuclear war in Europe, a threat of a major war or major conflagration in Asia, a potential catastrophe in the Middle East if any nuclear weapons get involved in any of those episodes. So trying to maintain this embargo and embarrassing itself is just incredibly stupid policy. What can I say? I'm sure that they don't give a diddly damn about me, but there are plenty of people who are former retired military, yeah, particularly the nuclear weapons tampering witnesses, the shutdown witnesses, that I think know that this is not good for the Air Force, it's not good for the Department of Defense, and it's not good for the country.
What was your main, for the hearings last week, what's your main takeaways from it?
Sure. The one thing I love the most, well, first, one takeaway is, of course, that it was filmed so much, so live stream, very important.
Totally, yeah.
The energy in the hall, the energy with all the people in there, just sky high. Okay, this is, of course, great. And it's nonpartisan, right? There's no partisan fighting going on in that hallway. It's nothing but excited people about learning the truth about the most important information in the world for us, our world. And then the packed room, they added 20 more, of course, it's packed. So you've got a really solid audience. And of course, the panel is loving that, the committees. And then the witnesses walked in. It was all very nicely done. Then the witnesses walked in from the right rear entrance, came in and then came around and then to sit at the tables. And as they're coming and sit at the tables, the entire room breaks out in applause. That did not happen at the first hearing. And so that applause was being heard around the world. Again, they were applauding witnesses for being heroes and having the courage to put at risk their legacy to some degree and subjugate themselves to some nonsense these days. It's almost impossible to avoid it. They were applauding them for that, to come in and tell that truth. That message I sure got across. So that was good. And then Elizondo immediately starts off. He finally, after 7 years, got a chance to testify before Congress. Of course, he wanted to do that.
Yeah.
And he immediately just hits it right on. There is a non-human presence, right? Yeah. We have a crash vehicle. The government has not been telling the truth on this. Boom, bam, boom, right off. And then, of course, you have all the rest of the testimony, which is covering a lot of areas. Gallaudet had an amazing story about an incident where a whole, I guess you could say a fleet action, an email went out to the entire fleet about a problem with something in the sky, essentially, and that please get in touch if you see anything. And then it was immediately removed, gone, just disappeared. A minor thing. But coming from that admiral firsthand, and think of thousands upon thousands of examples like that. And you know what it's like to have served in the Air Force and Navy going back 70 years. Okay. So that was kind of cool. NASA was brought up really for the first time in a hearing on this subject. Mm-hmm. I don't think it came up in the Grush hearings. And while it was kind of complicated, let's just say that they pointed out that NASA has a vast, vast archive of information, video, photos, and everything else, which almost certainly included ET, non-human related stuff that is either lost in those archives, because they have millions of photos. I mean, they could be in there, you could never find them. Yeah. But we have one very, very a courageous and important witness. Her name was Donna Hare, who worked for the NASA. She just recently passed. God bless her. And she was one of the few people who had the guts to testify that she actually personally witnessed NASA airbrushing these types of things out of photos. Not because NASA wanted to, but because NASA had to. The 1958 Space Act prevents NASA from doing anything that the Department of Defense considers a national security matter. Period. And they could find an entire civilization on the back of the moon. They couldn't say a thing except tell the Department of Defense, we have found a civilization on the back of the moon. And the department says, thank you for letting us know that. If you utter a word about this, everybody's going to go to jail, whatever. Mm-hmm. That's how NASA's had to operate since 1958. And so mentioning the NASA archives, and they talked about, well, if we could go into those archives with AI, it'd be helpful to, advance this issue. Nah, we don't have time for that. We don't need to. But post-disclosure, they're going to use some AI systems and they're going to go in and they're going to just pull stuff out of the files. And of course, I think NASA might very well be authorized as part of the UAP Disclosure Act, there is one. It lost a lot of its powers, but they can be put back anytime. Mm-hmm. Basically give NASA the ability, would you please bring the original photos and so forth and imagery that you have, that you had to airbrush the ET stuff out, and we'd like to have that in the archive. And then NASA will be free at last, good God almighty, free at last to be able to be a fully transparent space agency, which it deserves to be. And working for NASA will be a hell of a lot less stressful, and they can continue to do wonderful things. One more reason why the truth embargo must end.
Yeah, that was one of the best kind of takeaways for Mike Gold in regards to the data NASA's got. I mean, right. We all know it exists. And it's just getting to that. Nothing was mentioned in regards to the kind of NASA kind of hearing they had back in, when was it, 2000, was it 23, 22? When NASA had the investigation or report that they put out, the panel and
it's
stuff.
Not a
like
report,
that.
Right?
All
that's for show.
Yeah,
NASA
totally.
Had to be brought into this process, which is basically all is setting up for a disclosure. It's not about finding out this stuff. They already know it.
Yeah, totally.
And so they set up a study, came out with a report. The report obviously didn't do much, but they're showing the flag. They're showing participation.
Yeah.
And that is to mitigate the public's discontent once we learn that, everybody was lying. The Air Force, the Navy, the Marines, the Army, the Pentagon, the CIA, the NSA, NASA, everybody was lying. Okay. But, let's move forward. So that's what that was about. But that's going to get real pretty soon.
There was a lot of good questions. And for the congressmen and women, and you could tell as well that there was no issue in them asking any type of questions. It was like the stigma had been totally lifted.
Oh yeah, there's no stigma anymore.
It's no there. I mean,
anybody that tries to go in that angle, there's still a few, even on the internet, they get trolled.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, they get come up with some stupid, ridiculous. Yeah, and then boom, the comments kind of pound at them.
Yeah.
Their day is over. Okay. So, legitimate. How would you say analysts that are willing to sort and point out where there seems to be some uncertainties here or whatever?
Yeah.
That's fine. But anything remotely like a skeptobunker, which is skeptical debunker, they need to find another line of work because it's not going to be fun for them.
Yeah, totally. I mean, it was refreshing to see that. Even between the two hearings, like for the hearing when Grush was there to this hearing, the difference in engagement from the congressmen and women in regards to the questions they were asking and the knowledge that they had on the subject, they weren't just reading a pre written question for them. They were actually asking questions that they maybe had a bit of knowledge about or something that they'd picked up in regards to maybe some of the briefings they've had and things like that.
Sure. Leading up to that hearing, there had been countless private meetings on the Hill between witnesses and others and members of Congress as they try to get up to speed on this. Mm-hmm. And of course, that's all private. We don't know how many, but it was a lot. And so, again, that's another reason why this process is irreversible. Unless they arrest all the congressional members and take them to a unknown in a location, they're going to keep getting meetings with witnesses and so forth and researchers. I've even had one or two, might have some more soon, and just getting more and more knowledgeable. So the DOD, what do they expect is going to happen? They need to get going here because things are getting very, very risky. And that brings me to one of the most important things that has happened in both of those hearings. We are in one of the most ugly political periods of our country. There have been others without question. Certainly the politics leading up to the Civil War in the United States was pretty bad. Mm-hmm. And ultimately the country was divided, went to war, hundreds of thousands of people killed. So I dare not miss it, compare it to that, except that now, as we're going through this very ugly time, just, death match politics with all matter of craziness and stuff going on. While it's not the Civil War, if there is a war, it will not be with muskets. It will be with nuclear weapons. And so this is an extremely dangerous time, and the politics is a mess and brutally partisan. Now, anyone that has watched these hearings, anyone that's paying attention knows that members of Congress have repeatedly gone out of their way to point out how nonpartisan this issue is. Mm-hmm. Not just acting nonpartisan, they're pointing out how nonpartisan it is. And they're working together fine. No problems. There's nothing that has come up in these hearings. Just a little taste here in the first hearing, a bit of a taste in the second hearing. And that's literally, you know, I mean, the last hearing was 23, as the campaign is getting really going. And this one, of course, was after the election. But still, I mean, just, and so I would suggest that this hearing is the way out of this morass. It's the door we can finally get out of the, you know, the panic room, right? Mm-hmm. Ride this issue to a more less partisan time where people start working together on other things, not just ending the truth embargo. Mm-hmm. And if that happens, oh, that's just a blessing. I mean, it would just be extraordinarily helpful to this country. So, and this is the only issue they can say that about. They can't find another. There isn't another issue that I am aware of that they can be nonpartisan about. Mm-hmm. Period. Nothing. Zero. Nada. Nietzsche vo. Bupkis. Nothing except this. Now, and the fact that it happens to be the most profound issue in history, which is part of the reason it's nonpartisan. They kind of recognize that, is helpful. So that may be one of the most important outcomes here. Not that we learn about the ET presence. There are millions upon hundreds of millions of people in the world right now that are absolutely certain there is an ET presence.
Yeah.
And quite a few that know there is an ET presence as the direct result of their work. But it is this potential for it to bring countries and political parties together in concert. And then to what degree will that carry over into other areas? Anything that helps. But if we don't get out of this and get into a cooperative mode and start fixing stuff,
yeah,
the American experiment could easily come to an end, and civilization itself could go to places that we don't even want to talk about. Mm-hmm. So that's the way it is. Yeah. You know, it's not my fault, but we're on board this ship, right? As it's about to sink, what call it bad luck, call it good luck, but it's up to us to prevent that. You know, patch the holes, get the thing going, and keep the ship afloat. Because if we don't, we're going down.
I know there was some good takeaways in regards from, I'd say, all the witnesses had some good nuggets in there. Like, for example, Lou Elizondo, in regards to getting the question on crash retrievals. Yeah. And he said he couldn't talk about, that was one thing he couldn't talk about, which obviously relays that he has been briefed or read into something in regards to that. A few other good things, I mean, in it, but is there any questions you would have liked to have heard asked?
Sure. A couple of hundred.
yeah.
But yeah, and the reason I don't really go there, I never go there, because just because I would like to have it asked, does that mean it should be asked? Not necessarily. This is a complex, difficult chess game that's being played. Mm-hmm. And it's like people, you know, it's like people watching a world championship chess match between two grandmasters, you know.
Yep.
Asking, is there a move that you would have liked them to make? You know,
yeah, it's like, I'll rephrase the question because I know I would like to ask a lot of questions and I'd like to hear a lot of answers to the questions, but do you think there was any questions not asked that was a missed opportunity to maybe
that is
highlight
tricky.
Something?
Again, most of these kinds of most people would answer this based upon something they want to know.
Yeah, probably. Yeah.
Let me be clear. And I never fail to, mention this to everybody so that they can be a little less irritated by the process underway. Mm-hmm. These hearings, the four pieces of legislation that have been passed. Is it four? Let's see, 2021, 2022, 2023, 2024, right? Four. The fifth one didn't get submitted for next year. That's a long story, but it's okay.
Yeah.
The creation of Arrow and everything else that you've read about has nothing to do at all with trying to find out what's going on. Mm-hmm. Nothing. Okay. They know pretty much what's going on. They know about the ETs. They have the tech. They have bodies. You know, they've spent a fortune monitoring, tracking, and dealing with it, not to mention a fortune on re-engineering, both in government labs as well as defense labs. Mm-hmm. They spent a fortune on secrecy and what have you. They know about this. The reason we're going all through this and we're seeing all this happening is not that. It is to set up this infrastructure to get to a place that where they need to be, mm-hmm. if the president's going to disclose, or if another head of state discloses first. And it's really simple if you turn it around this way. Imagine if you woke up on Monday, let's say seven years ago, before the To the Stars Academy group came out.
Yeah.
Let's go back to 2013. And a head of state out there came forward and said, absolute certainty there's an ET presence, provided quite a bit of evidence and essentially confirmed to the people, the citizens of that nation, that there was an ET presence that would rocket around the world. Mm-hmm. And within a day or two, our president would be facing, and the Pentagon would be facing a couple thousand journalists, mm-hmm. with a million questions. And no legislation, no UFO study over the NASA, no arrow, no briefings of Congress, nothing. Just all of a sudden, what's going on? It would be absolute chaos. Mm-hmm. It would be embarrassing. It would be chaotic. It would be dangerous. It would be destructive. It would be a colossal fiasco. And then the resentments, when ultimately, of course, everybody understands they've been lying for 70 years, would be 10 times worse.
Yeah.
Calling for resignations, suits, lawsuits, retributions, whatever the hell. It'd go on and on. It'd be a complete disaster. And they know that. I mean, they have lots of computers that can tell them that. And so when they started to realize that the truth embargo really could not last, when they realized the dam was already cracking and at any time the whole thing was going to unload downstream, they realized they'd got to get together on that. They got to get prepared for this. Mm-hmm. And good for them. But they had a real problem, a problem with their own making. Is that they couldn't do this in secret. I mean, they had to, you know, they had to do this publicly. They had to create all of the structure publicly. People would see it, but they couldn't tell them why. They couldn't tell them the truth as to why. They couldn't say, we got to get this stuff together here because there's ETs here. No, that's disclosure. And so, and that only can come from the president, at least as I define it. And yeah. One way to do this with the president would go in front of the people and say, you know, there's extraterrestrials here and we got to get some laws passed. We got to get arrows set up. We got to do all this stuff. And people are saying, God, what? forget laws. What are you saying? There's extraterrestrials. But look, I don't really want to talk about it anymore until we get all that stuff done. It'll take 3 or 4 years. I mean, you can't do it that way. And so they had to do it in such a way that you would be comfortable, that you would accept it if you really knew what was going on, and you would be pleased if you didn't know what was going on, mm-hmm. but you couldn't know the truth. They had to lie their way out from under a massive lie to achieve the truth, to get to the truth, to get to being able to tell the truth. They had to lie out from under a bigger lie for a higher purpose. Awkward, a problem of their own making. I understand. I'm okay. I'm not losing any sleep over that. But I'm not losing any opportunity to inform the people that's what's going on. And if the Washington Post would interview me, I'd tell them. CNN, I'd tell them. But you know, because I keep telling the truth to these people, when they show up, they stop coming. And so I used the podcast army to do it. And I've probably done 300 podcast interviews easily, and I've done 2,000 interviews overall. So I'm gonna put the message up. You know, mm-hmm. chill. It's okay. I know you're angry. I know why not this? Why didn't they say that? What the hell's going on? That doesn't make sense. I get it. I understand. There is a reason we're having to go through this. And it shouldn't have been this long. It didn't have to take this many years. But when they started to make their move, which was 2017, late 2017, when the chess game or the end game of the chess game began, it's been an interesting 7 years. Had it been less interesting, I think we would already be well into the post-disclosure world. And so while the first 2 years after the New York Times articles in December of 17, were pretty well, but there was it's a process that was developing from the inside out and what have you, and the public were learning, and it went pretty well. And then somebody walked out of the Wuhan lab and went down to buy some fish at the market. And unfortunately, dragged a little coronavirus with him and launched the worst pandemic in terms of its total economic impact. Mm-hmm. And of course, massive death in modern history, upsetting. I mean, and one that went on is still, there is still disease. There's still plenty of people getting it. Fortunately, the death rate's down. But again, it was a catastrophe, and it cost trillions of dollars. And so that happened. And then what we saw, they're having to advance this process, trying to set up this structure to get ready for disclosure. And they're working through that in 2020. You know, it's not easy. A lot of people are going bankrupt, a lot of projects. I had a few myself. Forget that. They're gone. Nobody's life's getting any better. And then we're starting to get back on our feet. And then Russia decides they need to rebuild the old empire. And the most dangerous war, maybe the most dangerous war since the Korean War. And well, not so dangerous because not enough nukes are in place, but possibly the most dangerous war in the nuclear era.
Yeah, totally.
More dangerous than the Iraq War, more dangerous than Afghanistan. More dangerous than anyone you want to take, okay? Mm-hmm. Something happens, gets underway. Still underway all this time. Risk of nukes growing every year. Now extremely risky. Mm-hmm. A lot of people are leaving the country, literally, okay?
Yeah.
So that for that reason, this has taken longer than it should have, which means that this rather awkward situation where they're having to do a whole bunch of stuff, but not give you the truth why, in order to get to the truth that must come from the president, is dragging out, and people's patience is thin. They're angry, they're frustrated, and the internet does not handle frustration well. But on the other hand, the internet provides the opportunity for hundreds of billions, if not millions of people to express their irritation. That's good. So the idea that you can just have your little private secret games with your secret labs and your underground bunkers and all your classification and your USAPs and your SAPs and your special access and all of that stuff, get a nice paycheck, enjoy your life and not be bothered. That ship sailed a long time ago, and it's nothing but hurricane waters going forward. So they have to get it done, and we're so close. And so I'm going to be doing everything I can to get ready for the post-disclosure world, which is why I've converted Paradigm Research Group from a sole proprietorship under the Constitution. Yeah, it just makes it harder for them to piss with me, and into a nonprofit 501c3 based in District of Columbia, and very soon I'll be raising tax deductible funding, which is going to allow PRG to do a lot more leading up to disclosure and also engage the post disclosure world as a think tank. So that's happening. The new Paradigm Institute is now, I think, in the second year and growing. Very important. NewParadigmInstitute.org. It's also a 501c3. Mm-hmm. You've got Hollywood Disclosure Alliance, which I founded with Dan Harari in Los Angeles. It's a 501c3 networking organization. It's not commercial. It's designed to simply help people get together and make important content by having a dual member list, Hollywood members, UAP members, right? Mm-hmm. And we've got a lot of pretty well-known Hollywood people, film people, And we've got some well-known UAP people, and we're helping them get together with cross, in other words, that way, and also within their own group, right? And then outside people can network into this. So that Hollywood Disclosure Alliance is really a righteous organization. Love to see some serious funding there, because we could do a lot if we had it. And then you've got a brand new scientific think tank called Soul Foundation out of Stanford. Gary Nolan started that. You've got the UAP Disclosure Fund out of San Francisco, which held a very special VIP invitation only get together with the press and others and witnesses after the hearing on the 13th on the Hill. Okay. In other words, this issue is going uptown, upscale. All right. You know, it's like, we're the happening thing. Pretty soon I'm going to need a tuxedo to go to some of this stuff. And so the Air Force, I mean, the DOD is just sitting there going, you know, why didn't we get an invitation? We would have liked to have gone to that. I'm so sorry. Again, this is a kind of a sense of what's going on. I'm trying to be positive, but I understand that there are still some serious risks to the process and a risk to everything. It's a very, I'll tell you, I do have to take some, how would you say, anxiety drugs. That's okay. But I'll tell you, I'm never bored. Never bored. So I'll tell you, that was the biggest problem in my life. The first half of my life was I was just bored to death. My fault. Just kind of got off into nowhere. Nothing happening. And now 28 years I've been in this issue. Not a day went by that I was bored. Never. Never happened. And it's only going to get more interesting going forward. So I feel very blessed in that regard.
DVD is getting interesting, more interesting DVD. We've got like one cabal, which maybe many, at one point were thought about, we need to get this out. This is for the DOD or for that infrastructure. People like Lou Elizondo and others. Yeah.
Right.
Do you believe that, or why do you, have you any other kind of perception of why a kind of timeline was sent for, was kind of set with the aim to try and get this out? You always hear this 2027, 29. Have you any thoughts on that?
2017, 19, 17. No. In the simplest way is that after, as of 2017, well, really, 2000, I think about 2015, which was, 2015 was, Roswell's 47, 60 years would be, 60 years would be, CS 53 be 2007. No, is that right?
Could you
2007, 60 years. So 2017 is 70 years. So right around about 70 years after Roswell, maybe 68 years. And everything that had happened, all the thousands of books that were published, the hundreds of thousands of events that were studied, the thousands of witnesses that come, witnesses that have come forward, everything, you know, hundreds of movies, fictional, non-fictional, document, all of that piling up for all those years. Around that time, a significant element within the military intelligence complex, a lot of people had come to the personal conclusion that this really had to end. But trying to help facilitate that while in government was not going to work. And so a group of them decided that as retirees, essentially no longer under direct government paychecks, maybe some of the odd programs, contracts or something, though they risk all of those, they decided to make a move and come forward publicly, and they did. I think they intended to come forward public after Hillary Clinton won the election in 16 in the transition period, but she didn't. Ultimately, it was delayed about 10 months. It came public in October of 2017.
Yeah.
And that is the beginning of the end game. Now, did they have a timeline? I doubt it. I think they had a plan, what they needed to do. I think the timeline was essentially, let's get this thing going. Let's get it done. Because the longer it was going to take, they were going to be hanging out the dry. And they knew that. And so what you've seen is a concerted effort to move toward ending the truth embargo. You've seen some wins, you've seen some losses, but overall, it's never reversed since 2017. Mm-hmm. It has slowed down a couple of times, but it's never gone backwards. I don't think it's ever been totally stopped. It's been a steady, solid movement towards ending the embargo. Mm-hmm. Cool. And as we got closer and closer to the goal line, now I realize you're in Scotland, football, not a big thing. Not the same thing in soccer. Hey, yeah. when you start to close in on that goal, you know what happens, right? The other team gets right around there and they really tough it up.
I've just finished watching the game tonight.
To guard that goal line. Well, that's what's happening. As we got close, they got tougher. They started to get a little more desperate and try some things. And that's good.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm almost not angry with the Department of Defense for some of the nonsense they've pulled, the Arrow report and everything else, because it's just confirmation that they realize that it's almost over. And that's fair. Mm-hmm. Right. Right. And then once we score the goal, hopefully they'll be nice. You know, they'll be appreciative. Hey, you won. Shake hands. Come on up. Let's go have some beers, whatever. Maybe not. So again, that's the kind of how it's unfolding. And it is the end game for this chess game, which started in 47, is 7 years in and just about done. So it's a 77-year chess game. It may end up spilling into year 78. No, yeah, 78. But not far, I don't think. One lifespan. Oddly enough, I was born 6.5 months before Roswell. I was conceived 6.5 months after the bombs were dropped in Hiroshima, which is directly connected to the modern ETH. They're absolutely connected. Okay. And so in a sense, my entire life has followed like a sidecar to these two massive modern developments, the nuclear arms race and the emergence of a process to end the lies about the presence of ETs, all mirrored. So anybody that's younger than, that's not older than 78, has lived every second of their life under a nuclear arms race of mutual assured destruction and the modern era of the emergence of the ET presence, for good or for ill, right? If you're older than that, you had a couple of years where that wasn't going on, but that's it. And then the kids that are born recently, the millennials and the Zs, I'm sure they're trying to figure this out. I don't envy them. They don't know much about it. They don't need to know much about it. And they just see aliens in movies and stuff. And so now all of a sudden, what? And so, but yeah, I think ultimately they'll be very excited. Some of them already are. Mm-hmm. But again, it's tough for them. And they're having to deal with everything else. They're having to deal with social media and all this technology and phones, you know, and AI, mm-hmm. a crowded world, 8 billion. So they got a lot in their plate. So I don't blame them if they don't just jump into this issue, and they don't. You can go to conference after conference, you rarely see a teenager, right? Mm. And I get that, it's okay, but they're going to be spending most of their life in the post-disclosure world, and so the sooner we end the truth embargo, so perhaps they can start getting a little more information about it, would be helpful. Mm-hmm. And when they do get the information, I think they're going to get really excited, and you're going to have a whole new energy worldwide now.
Yeah.
From the teenagers and the 20-year-olds are going to realize, my God, I could go to the stars. Oh, I could learn about ETs, literally from ETs. Okay, mm-hmm. this is unbelievable. This is a little more profound than, you know, a couple hundred years ago when the world kind of figured out that it went around the sun, and not the other way around. I mean, it was like, you know, okay, good, yeah, but it still just goes across the sky like it always does. What the hell difference does it make? This is not like that. That was a significant change of worldview, but this is way bigger than that. This will be the greatest worldview change in all of history.
Have you any thoughts at all on one thing I was wanting to ask you, just to see if you had any thoughts on it, or you dismiss it, or you've got a thought on it. Like John Ramirez, who ex-CIA, had came out and said they potentially some type of event in 2027.
Yeah.
And Lou Elizondo has alluded to potentially something that he knows about but can't talk about. He'd said that in the Good Trouble show when he was talking to Matt Ford. Have you any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I think that there are people that maybe know some things that allows them to put a date on something. That's fine. The future is still uncertain, and nobody can predict it unless it's predetermined, and I don't want to live in a predetermined universe. I do something similar, but not kind of like that. I don't know what their sources are. I don't have a source for this. This is purely the exercising of my common sense.
Yeah.
But as I've said many times, I think we've been heading for disclosure since 47. It's about here. Disclosure will open the issue up worldwide, and it will be embraced with enthusiasm. I think in about 2 years, the whole world will be very much informed about this issue.
Yeah.
The stigma, of course, will be completely gone. And starting to get bored, because that's the way humans are. I mean, we get bored very easily, and we normalize everything. We've normalized nuclear weapons. Nuclear weapons, what can you do? And about that time is when the ETs could go open contact, and we could literally be having open, recorded and conveyed discussions between one or more types of extraterrestrials and our authorities about what they're looking for and what questions we may have asked. And I put that at 2 years. I think 2 years is enough. I don't think we need more than 2 years to get to that place. We could do it in one.
Yeah.
And so, in that sense, I've been saying this for a long time. And at this point, since we're already in late 2024, if we get disclosure in the next 60 days or before March, then you're looking at 2027. Mm-hmm. Well, actually, you're looking at the end of 2026 or 2027, about 2 years right in there.
You definitely know the mood has shifted when you're getting congresswomen asking about genetic manipulation and hybrids and things like that in the middle of a hearing. So it's definitely shifted.
There's a vast amount of information that is coming. But it's not coming until after disclosure.
Yeah.
It's that simple. People say, well, why not now? Well, you want disclosure, or you just want to go around in circles for the next 100 years. No. A lot of this information is not conducive to this political process underway that leads to confirmation.
Yeah, totally.
However, once confirmation is out of the way, and it will be worldwide, everything's on the table. And it'll all be on the table a lot sooner than I think governments think. I mean, they think, okay, right, well, you know, I'm gonna take a little while, we're gonna rush this, and that'll come out, you know, in 2 years, that'll come out in 5 years, whatever they think the time frame is. It's going to be faster than that, because they really can't appreciate how intense it's going to be. They've got AI and supercomputers, and they may have already asked it, and maybe the AI supercomputer came back and said, yeah, don't worry, 5-8 years, people will be patient. They need to get another AI program, because that's not the way it's going to be. It's going to be intense beyond imagination, and they're going to need to service that intensity, but responsibly. Mm-hmm. So what they thought might take 7 years to get done and out may get done in 2 years. We shall see. But again, that maybe hasn't happened yet.
Or maybe it's 80 years, and then the documentation that they're all, which is keeping the secret in, maybe that ends in 80 years, which will be 2027.
the UFO UAP Disclosure Act, as initially written, now sort of appropriate, but is still missing certain key elements, which may be hopefully returned to it, was the total deal. I mean, Senator Schumer rocked the world of the military intelligence complex when he came out with that in July of 2023. It's the total package. It is the vehicle that will allow the United States to get it all out, everything, every little bit, every body, every piece of tech, every piece of information, all the documents and everything else, with the most sensitive and potentially national security order coming out very last. Mm-hmm. But it's all coming out. We have that. And we could, well, we had it for a while. Now it's been pared back a little bit, but okay. We can easily return it to its full powers.
Yeah.
And that's it. And if you look at it, you can sort of say, you can get a sense of, well, using that law, how long would it take? And again, 6 years could be right. Four, right? Mm-hmm. 10 years, 12 years, not a chance. And people say, well, I don't want to wait that long. You'll be fine, right? It may take 5 years to get it all, but I assure you, there's going to be stuff coming out every month, right? Yeah. If not every week. So you'll be fine. You'll be like, oh, wow. And you'll be able to see it all happen. You'll be very happy, mm-hmm. right? So you're not going to have to sit around and wait much time between this new information, that new doc. No, it's going to be a stream of stuff just coming out for as long as it takes to empty the vaults. Mm-hmm. And that's going to be happening in other countries, not just us.
Yeah.
Which is another reason why we can't drag our feet too much.
The five eyes.
So, again,
yeah.
I've waited my whole life for this. And if it takes, say, 6 years, I'll be 84 when they empty the vaults. I'm trying to be optimistic about that, but you know, that's optimism. It takes more than that. And let's end on this note, if I may, because I think it's appropriate right now. We just lost another member of the UAP activist, research journalist, documentarist, community, a wonderful man who I've known for a long time. I've done his show many times. Howard Hughes passed about a month ago.
Yeah.
The UK journalist who had many shows, including The Unexplained.
Great voice.
A wonderful human being. And he's gone to us now.
Yeah. Well, Steve, it's been great speaking to you. And I do appreciate everything you do. And I'm sure the listeners do as well. And keep at it. I mean, so do really well. So listen, end it there. And thanks very much for all you do.
My pleasure, sir. If you ever need a host at the last minute, I mean, a guest at the last minute, this is what I do. If there's a fair chance you call me up, I could have a computer up in 5 minutes. So
yeah,
don't brilliant. Hesitate. You're part of the podcast army, my friend.
Yeah.
We're gonna get the end the embargo one podcast at a time.
Definitely take you up on that, Steve, and it's been good talking to you. I'll get off my bed now.
Yeah, it's late, my friend. Get some sleep.
Brilliant. All right. Listen, Steve. Great talking to you. I'll see you later, buddy. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Thanks again for listening, everyone. That's a wrap tonight. And don't forget to subscribe, share, and like the content if you like it, that is. And also, even leave a review. It helps with the algorithms, helps us grow, and brings more content to the show. Thanks again, and catch you all soon.